الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن الا وانتم مسلمون يا ايها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحده وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والارحام ان الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم اعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما اما بعد فان اصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. My brothers and sisters, a few minutes ago there was an announcement about the death of one of us. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take him to Firdaus, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive his sins. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this death for him a rest, a complete rest, until the day of judgment where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant him Jannah, inshaAllah. But my brothers and sisters, I see it as a message actually to us, the living ones. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَكْفِرُوا مِنْ ذِكْرِ هَادِ مِنْ لَذَّاتِ. You should constantly remember the historia of the plagues, and that's death. Uthman radiallahu anhu says, I never saw a place, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I never saw a place which is more scary than the grave. He went to the place of Uthman radiallahu anhu and he cried a lot. When people asked him about the reason why he cries, he told them this hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Qabr أول منزل من منازل الآخرة فإن نجا منه أحد كان ما بعده أيسر منه. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the first stage of the hereafter is the grave. The grave is the first stage, the place where a Muslim is supposed to have a transit before he moves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, if you pass the test in the grave, then whatever comes after that is much easier. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam always mentioned in the hadith of Al-Bara ibn Azim, when he says about the believer who is receiving a test in that place, he says, this is the last fitna that the believer is going to receive in his life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the grave of this brother ours a place of rest, inshallah, and gives him tranquility to answer all of the questions. I was intending to talk about one of the most important topics that I think Muslims should remind themselves about, which is about the seven people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to put them under the shade of his arsh in the hereafter. It's a very big topic, so we'll take some part of it. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wish we come back here, we will continue with Allah ta'ala. In the hadith that is narrated by Abu Huraira, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, سَبْعَةٌ يُذِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ذِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. There will be seven people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to put them under the shade of the arsh in the hereafter. You know, in another hadith which is narrated by Abu Huraira, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us some of the scenario that will take place in the hereafter, which has a greater connection with this hadith. He says, on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring everyone. So we will be coming back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the final and the last day. And this day is very harsh in the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described it. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the difficulty and the hardship will reach its peak in such a way people will never be able to bear it at all. And then we're tadru shamsu. This is what I need concerning this issue. And the sun is going to come closer to the people. And you know what the scientists are telling us nowadays? That the distance between you and the sun is around 93 million miles. And you can see in some places it's too hot, you cannot even come out of your house. What do you think if Allah's Messenger is going to bring it next to you just like a man? My brothers and sisters, wallahi, it wasn't a joke. It is a serious issue that a Muslim should really be prepared. As you already know that life on the face of the earth, life on the face of the earth should be based on the realization of that real purpose that Allah SWT brought you here for, which is to worship and serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatsoever contradicts what Allah SWT wants, it is better for a Muslim, it is right for a Muslim to stay away from it, because sooner you will be taken back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the accountability is very harsh. So let's be very serious about this. So in this day, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the sun will come very close to the people. Who will succeed on this day? There are a lot. One of these people that will succeed on that day, they are the seven people mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said there will be seven people that Allah SWT put under the shade of the arsh. They will not suffer from the heat of the sun. And being under that shade is a blessing. Because you find nobody there except the prophets and the messengers and the righteous people. That will give you comfort to cause you might forget the suffering. Apart from the shade you get, being next to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the messenger of Allah SWT and the prophet, is enough to give you a number of comfort you need to succeed on that day. So who are these seven people? The first one mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a just ruler. He says, Al-Imam Al-Adil. Al-Imam Al-Adil, the just ruler. Leadership is responsibility, is amanah, is accountability. And it's a very huge amanah that whoever takes it should always remember this, that he is going to be held responsible for every single person that was under his guardianship and control. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا مِنْ رَاعٍ يَسْتَدْعِيهِ اللَّهُ رَعِيَّتَهِ يَمُوتُ يَوْمَ يَمُوتُ وَهُوَ غَاشٌ لِرَعِيَّتِهِ إِلَّا حَبَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ. That's why, wallahi, my brothers and sisters, the early predecessors, the people of the past, they used to run away from it, because they know their accountability is so high. Umar radiallahu anhu, when he was about to die, he used to say, I wish I never took a responsibility in my life. And you know who was Umar? The best leader that the world ever saw after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr. People used to come to Medina just to see who is Umar radiallahu anhu because of justice. But the man, when he was going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that was his statement. Because they understood how harsh is the situation of a leader if he is not just. That's the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, we as a member of the community, we should be aware of this. Instead of taking aside, cursing the leaders, talking against, saying whatever you want to say, make dua for them. That's what we learn from our own scholars. Because they are going to be in trouble if they don't go in the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. So they need your dua, they need your cooperation, they need your help. A Muslim has no right to make dua against a leader. The Prophet did not guide us towards this. He says, Ad-deen al-nasiha. Deen, religion, is nasiha. And one of the places of this nasiha, he says, wa liya immatil muslimina wa ammatihim. Nasiha to the leader is to advise him when he goes against the direction. And how do you advise him? You don't come and talk in the manamin about what they do. That's wrong. You don't go in public and talk about what they do. That's wrong. And the scholars mentioned, even if you have access to them and talk to them, it should be in secret. And you're not allowed to come back to the community and talk about that. Because it would never bring good, it would bring evil. Imam Muhammad used to say, if I can have one chance to make dua, which is for myself, I will never do dua for myself, I will make dua for the leader to be righteous. Because if the leader is righteous, everything is going to be righteous. So back to that hadith that I quote, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا مِنْ رَاعٍ يَسْتَلْعِيهِ اللَّهُ رَعِيَّةً. There will not be the ruler that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him or asked him to be, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted him the responsibility of a people. يَمُوتُ يَوْمَ يَمُوتُ وَهُوَ غَاشٌ لِرَعِيَّتِهِ إِلَّا حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةَ. if he lets himself to die as a cheater, as somebody who cheated in his responsibility, he betrayed the amana that Allah's heart had granted him, Allah's heart is going to make Jannah haram upon him. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Satakunu nadabatan yawm al-qiyamah. He talks about leadership, he said, it is going to be a regret in the hereafter. So we'll conclude this issue with the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that says, Kullukum ra'i wa kullukum mas'ulun 'an ra'iyatihi. Every one of you is a shepherd, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold him accountable of what he asked him to be responsible of. And the first person the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned is a leader. And you know, this hadith is very comprehensive. Leadership is not just restricted in the higher authorities. No, you also as a husband, as a wife, as a principal, a rector, dean, or whoever, head of department, you are responsible, you are in charge of something, and Allah's heart is going to hold you accountable of that in the hereafter. And you know one of the secrets of that mention of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Ra'i, he called him a Ra'i. Ra'i is a shepherd, somebody who is taking care of a sheep. One of the people, one of the speakers was making an analysis. He says, if you look at the animals, one of the animals that has no defense in life, except the one who is taking care of it, is a sheep. Wherever you see the picture of a sheep, you see the Ra'i, the shepherd next to them. Why? Because they need somebody to be with them constantly. What does that mean? A leader cannot sleep. He has to be very vigilant and awake to make sure that things are going nice. That's the reason why the community is just like the sheep and he's not like the shepherd. We are in a state of sleep, and if the leader sleeps, we will go astray. He has to be awake at every single moment to make sure that things are going in the proper manner. يا الله سبحانه وتعالى أريدس أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. One of those people mentioned by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, وشاب نشأ في طاعة الله أو في عبادة الله. We have an Imam al-Adil, the righteous and the just ruler. The reward that Allah SWT will give him is to put him under the shade of the Arsh in the hereafter. A second person is a righteous person who was grown up upon righteousness. So my brothers and sisters, this is the good news actually to the youth and the young ones. You should wake up and remember that this is the best age that people are wishing nowadays, if Allah SWT can take them back to that so that they can fix their attitude. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, those of us who are at the young age, you should always remember this. That alhamdulillah, you are in a moment whereby you have people to come and remind you about these issues. A lot of people, they do not get this opportunity when they're young. They have to look for it in the future. But you have somebody to remind you. So one of the good news that I should convey to you is, if you can maintain a righteousness from childhood, from the day you become a matured person, Allah SWT is going to reward you a greater reward. And the best reward that you will receive in the hereafter is to be under the shade of the Arsh of Allah SWT in the hereafter. My brothers and sisters, wallahi, to me there is no reward which is greater than this. Because it shows a clear sign that inshallah, Allah SWT is going to give you what is better than what you are seeing now, which is to be under the shade of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know, one of the things also that I will remind you, the young ones, is if you are righteous and you fix your life and you become a good one, you are supporting the community to bring good to the community. And also, one of the early rewards that you're going to receive in this life is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, is going to protect your limbs and your parts when you grow older. They met one of the righteous predecessors, and he was very strong, and he was healthy, but he was too old. This is who they used to be. One of them was at the age of 123, but he was the Imam in the Taraweeh. One of them did not even have one single white hair, and he goes beyond 100 years. They have a lot of people. One of them was asked, what is the secret between this health and protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You know what he says? He says, تلك هي جوارحه حفظناها في الصغر فحفظها الله علينا في الكبر. He said, these are the limbs and the parts that we protected them. We protected them by doing what Allah SWT wants. How do I protect my limbs at a young age? Before the old age comes, look at the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he addressed that young companion. He says, "Ya Bula, inni mu'allimuka kalimatin, ihfad Allah yahfadhuk." Nowadays, if you give advice to the children, people will comment, "No, you shouldn't do that. They're so young." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never did this. He started teaching children from the young age. He went to the house, he found Umar ibn Abi Salama, he was eating from every place. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, he said, Ya Ghulam, he called him, he said, holy young boy, eat with your right hand, eat what comes next to you, and say Bismillah. And he said to the father, he said, teach your children how to pray, start asking them to pray from the younger age, from 7 years. If they reach 10 years and they don't pray, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, beat them for it. Because if you start from that moment before they reach the old age, or before they reach the age of maturity, they will be familiar with it. It will not be strange things to them. So as I said, the best thing to remind our young ones is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that says, Ya Ula, ihfad Allah yahfadhuk. He says, oh, the young boy, ihfadillah. Ihfadillah means take care of the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do what you're told to do and stay away from things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want you to do. That's the meaning of hifzullah. And wallahi, I wish you have time to go through the deep meaning of this hadith, because if you understand it properly, I tell you, my brothers and sisters, you will enjoy life on the face of the earth with a full protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali in his book Jabir al-Hikam, he did it beautifully when he talks about the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is protecting people. He said, min ajib hifzillahi ala al-abd. He says, sometimes one of the most amazing ways that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using to protect a person, sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring your enemy to be your protectors. And he wrote a lot of stories to support his idea. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you here on the face of the earth, and the greatest protection that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you as a young one, or anyone who is applying this hadith that says, ihfadillaha yahfadhuka, take care of the religion of Allah, do the commands and stay away from the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want to do, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you. If you do that, you will receive the greater protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's all ponder upon this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and reflect upon it. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us iman and awareness to remember all of these remembrances from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and practice what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. My brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. I have never created human beings or jinn except to worship. So that person, he says, I was protecting my limbs and my parts when I was young, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected them for me when I became old person. So you also, you need this protection. You don't want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take you to that old age. You want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you strength to keep on doing what you're supposed to do. The best way for that is to watch over the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and put them into practice and action. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم.